Morning. I'm Tanner Schechter. Those who don't know, we appreciate you coming this morning. Glad you're here with us on All Saints Day. Please look over the bulletin. There's a few announcements in there. One is we have an outreach committee meeting at 11:45 today. 11:30, this says. And there's also, they're putting together some packets for the Sterling College students that are quarantined from exposure to 19. In order to encourage these students who are alone and away from home, we are taking donations for non-perishable snacks at the snack items to make care packages. Please bring your individually wrapped snacks to the church office. If you have any questions, get with Jonathan Conard. Also, we're having chicken dinners out Wednesday night out the back door, so those who love chicken, not me, can come by and get some. If there are no other announcements, please turn your attention to the worship team as we prepare our hearts for worship.
Well, good morning. As we prepare our hearts for worship this morning, I have just a couple of verses to share with you from 2 Timothy chapter 4. And it says, "For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will reward to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing." And I love this verse because it reminds us of the goodness that is waiting for us when we walk with the Lord. So let us stand and worship this morning. Let's worship the God who calls us his own and is preparing for us a crown in glory.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in his love. His love for me. Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me, his grace around. Yes, he died for me. Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child. Yes, I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am.
Sing that again.
I am chosen, not forsaken. For me, not against me. I am who you say. There's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Would you pray with me? Father God, thank you. Thank you for the privilege of being called your child. We are your children, God, and we rejoice in that this morning. And we rejoice in the idea of looking forward to the day when you will call us good and faithful servant. God, what an amazing sentence. And God, I just thank you that we have that to look forward to as we walk with you and as we grow with you and as we are sanctified by you. And God, on this All Saints Day, we remember all of those in our church family that have already heard those words from your lips, who have heard those words and are living in victory alongside you. God, how great you are. I thank you for their lives, for the example that they are to us. And we thank you for the ultimate example that you've given us in your Son, Jesus Christ, who paid the ultimate price for us, who died a terrible death on a cross, so that we could have this relationship with you, so we could have the assurance of eternity with you. Father, you are so good. Oh, you are so good. So we praise you this morning because we love you so much and we thank you for all that you have given. We pray all of this in your name. Amen.
Running after me. goodness is running after, it's running after me. My life laid down, I'm surrendered now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness.
In the celebration of All Saints' Day, William Nolan. Doris Gill. Phyllis Tieperman. Jerry Zimmerman. Lois Cruz. Gary Prophet. Mildred Finkhauser. Joan Kelly. Lonnie Elliott. Randy Dumler. Kim Thorne. Dale Turner.
If you'll bow your heads as I pray. Oh, Lord our God, we thank you for the many people throughout the ages who have followed your way of life joyfully, for the many saints and martyrs, men and women, who have offered up their very lives so that your life abundant may become manifest. Oh Lord, we thank you for those who choose the way of Jesus Christ. In the midst of trial, they held out hope. In the midst of hatred, they kindled love. In the midst of persecutions, they witnessed to your power. In the midst of despair, they clung to your promise. O Lord, we thank you for the truth they have passed on to us, that it is by giving that we receive. It is by becoming weak that we shall be strong. It is by loving others that we shall be loved. It is by offering ourselves that your kingdom shall unfold. It is by dying that we shall inherit life everlasting. Lord, give us courage to follow your way of life. Amen.
And together, as brothers and sisters in Christ, we honor those who have lived faithfully and have shared their lives with us. We did light one extra candle today in honor of all of those whose names we did not read today that you are remembering in your hearts. And may their light and love never be extinguished. Morning on this beautiful fall autumn day. I hope you're not too tired from raking leaves and standing tall in the wind, but I hope today's worship service where you find peace and you find rest and you find a sense of community. Today we begin a new sermon series that will take us to Advent. Can you believe we are on the verge that we're beginning to start talking about Advent, and what a year it has been. So before we go to Advent, though, I want to go back to the beginning. I'm going to go back to the very beginning of the Bible. We're going to start in Genesis today. And what a better place to launch our sermon series on first fruits then going back to the first book in the Bible. The very first story where we see that the beginning of life, the beginning of family life. And in Genesis chapter 4, it tells the story of the firstborn children to Adam and Eve, Cain and Abel. And their story is a story of first, indeed, as they are the first kids to have parents. They're the first pair of siblings, and I'm sure the first case of sibling rivalry. So so I can get an idea of the lay of the land here, just by a show of hands, how many oldest children do we have today? I am an oldest child. We're the leaders, right? Oh, I don't know. And then we have the youngest child. How many of you are the babies of the family? And then what about those who are the only child? Oh, there's one up in the balcony. Oh, and the middle child. The forgotten children. I knew it. I could just see hands going, come on, middle child. Come on, I'm here. I'm here. It doesn't make any difference which family you're from. Birth order does come into play, doesn't it? And look at this, even in our family of God, in our church family as well. For Mike and I, we have three children. Three times. totally different children with three totally distinctive personalities. One that if you would say the oldest child, the rule follower, would say, okay, Brett, now you just sit there. And he would just sit there. And if it was 2 days later, he'd still be just sitting there. And then we had his sister, our middle child. We'd say, Molly, you sit there. I don't have to sit here. Why do you want to make me sit here? Why isn't he sitting here? You know, and it just kind of that. And then we had the younger one, and we'd say, Andrew, we'll sit there. And it's kind of like, do I have to? And then he'd just be dancing around and making all these things, and it kind of got to the point, like, why bother even asking him to sit there, right? But anyway, isn't it amazing, those of you that have parents or grandchildren, that when you look at the how three or two or one distinctive personalities can come from the same set of biological parents? How does this happen? And this was exactly the case with Cain and Abel. They were no different than we are in the fact that they had the same biological parents, but they grew up to be quite different men. Cain, the firstborn, was the first to follow in Adam's footsteps as a farmer. And Abel grew up to be a shepherd. Now here's what the scripture tells us about the first family in Genesis chapter 4. And I'm going to begin reading at verse 2, and it says this. It says, now Abel kept flocks and Cain worked the soil. In the course of time, Cain brought some of the fruits of the soil as an offering to the Lord. And Abel also brought an offering, fat portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. The Lord looked with favor on Abel as his offering, but on Cain, his offering, he did not look with favor. So Cain was angry, and his face was downcast. Then the Lord said to Cain, why are you so angry? Why is your face so downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must rule over it. Now Cain said to his brother Abel, hey, let's go on out to the field. And while they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel, and he killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, where is your brother Abel? I don't know, he replied. Am I my brother's keeper? Now, scripturally, we are not specifically told why God was pleased with Abel's offerings over Cain's. But as modern-day humans, we might really want to speculate the fact that maybe it was because God preferred a good lamb steak over fruits and veggies. Or maybe it was just because he doted on the baby of the family just a little bit more. I mean, really, the baby gets all the attention and the applause, right? Right? Yep. See? And this just didn't set right with Cain. I mean, maybe he was just mad because Abel came along and interrupted his whole household. I don't know what the problem is, but this is probably an ongoing thing. But Cain could not let this be that Abel was lifted up. He was absolutely fuming, and his anger was manifested into a deep-seated hatred that resulted in the first known case of domestic violence. I mean, and we're also spared the gory details of Abel's death. As in verse 8, it just merely says that Cain attacked his brother and he killed him. And just for all those forensic fans and lovers of autopsy reports, that I have come to the conclusion, due to the evidence that we do have, that Abel died of heart failure. What? What do you mean? What do you mean he died of heart failure? Well, think about this, okay? Theology professor Claude Marinetti, in his article Cain and His Offering, published in 2013, contends that the reason Cain's offering is rejected is not because of something that Abel did, but it had everything to do with Cain's own attitude towards giving. And it's evidenced by the conversation that God had with him in verses 6 and 7, and he asked him point blank, "Why are you so angry?" God poses that question to Cain, and he says, "And why is your face so downcast?" And this line of questioning alludes to the idea that Cain gave half-heartedly while Abel was happy about giving to God. After God responded differently to the gifts, and Cain did not receive that correction well. So it becomes evident that Cain's heart was not in the right place. There's the heart failure part, right? Abel died not at the hands of his brother, but rather from the failure of Cain's heart. Cain's heart was misaligned. It was full of jealousy. It was full of a sense of entitlement, and it lacked a trust in the provision of God. You still with me? Had you thought of it that way before? Heart failure. See, Hebrews 11:4 seems to reinforce the idea that Cain's attitude was a major concern. And it says this, it says, "By faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offerings, and by faith, Abel still speaks even though he is dead." You see, God expects us to be good stewards of all that he has given to us and to show our love for him by offering our first and our best to him. Giving to God, or giving God our best, it is a reflection of our relationship with him. So if we don't think much of what he has done, then we probably aren't going to give easily or generously. Now, biblically, first fruits refers to the first portion of the harvest, which is given to God. Most notably, the first fruits are the first crops to come in. It is a kind of a pledge or a hope of a greater harvest to follow. And it is specifically set aside and dedicated to God. And it's also important for us to understand that the same is true for shepherds like Abel. As the firstborn of their flock, whether a human or beast, was also considered as God's special possession and can be also considered a first fruit. So offering first fruits means offering to God our very best without hesitation or regret. And this includes our finances, our time, gifts, or whatever he asks from us. First fruits are about choosing God first. And Abel wholeheartedly understood about first fruit living and giving to God. And in verse 4, we read that Abel's gift was indeed a first fruit offering. And there are no words tied to the gift of produce that was given by Cain. First fruit living, it's not about food, it's about the attitude. It's choosing. First fruit living is choosing to have an attitude of love and generosity. It's of love and of grace, even when someone is given accolades or praise when we are not. It's choosing to not let greed and jealousy overcome us so that we live in a conflicted state of the heart. We can't allow the seeds of envy to grow without taking a look in the mirror and asking ourselves pretty much the same things that God asked Cain when he said, "Why are you so angry?" when things aren't going our way and somebody gets something that we want, we've got to stop and check ourselves. What's our deal? What's our problem? Why are we so angry about this? And then brace ourselves for the answers that we might receive as we look to God to help us discern that. Because He just may ask us to change. And just as much, you may have heard the song, Fear is a Liar. I believe that just as much fear is a liar, anger is a murderer, as it sucks the life right out of everyday living. In the kingdom of God, love is the primary commodity. And when we have no love, we have no life. And we risk dying of heart failure too. God's response to Cain is a fitting response for us too. And He says, if you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must rule over it. When we're struggling with our pride or our envy or our greed, or when things don't go our way, maybe we just ask Satan to just get behind us, or tell him this is no place and you aren't having that today, and ask God for strength to push on through. You see, for us to be fully alive, for us to live out our best lives, our thoughts must align with God's. Our priorities must be God's priorities, which brings us back to the loaded question that was Cain's response when God asked him, "Where is your brother?" And Cain asked, "Well, am I my brother's keeper?" The book of Genesis is the first account of the first conflict, but it certainly is not the last. Even in the very beginning of creation, there was conflict. And conflict still exists today. Sibling rivalry still exists. But isn't it so interesting how diverse the offspring can be of one Heavenly Father? So church, where is your brother? Where is your sister? For we have been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters, but don't use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. Instead, use your freedom to serve one another in love. And that's Galatians chapter 5, verse 13. In a recent article published in Relevant Magazine, we are reminded that the Bible doesn't prohibit disagreements, but the Bible does not discourage us from disagreements, or doesn't prohibit disagreements. It doesn't discourage us from sharing our opinions or standing up for what we believe in. But the scriptures are very clear about a few things. That we have to love our enemies. We have to do whatever we can to live at peace with everyone. We have to avoid foolish arguments, and we have to be kind. The article goes on to say that if we call ourselves followers of Jesus, we have to take His word seriously. But if we are engaging in arguments, political or otherwise, we really have two choices: to follow the instructions that were given in the scriptures, or acknowledge that we call ourselves Christians, but we are really only interested in following God's commands that fit into our preferred way of living. In these tense political times, or times of the things and all of the events that are going on around us, it offers a vast opportunity to really sink down into a nasty level of discourse, whether it's on social media, or whether it's in phone conversations, or whether it's in face-to-face conversations. The door is open for conflict. I mean, when you look at the stats of the election, chances are on the big spectrum, 50% of the people, y'all voted different than one another, statistically. That sets up a huge natural divide. This offers us a time for a nasty level of discourse, but it also offers us a time as followers of Christ, an incredible opportunity to swing to the opposite side of the spectrum and to speak with humility and to show grace and to demonstrate that no matter how different we are, no matter how different we voted or what how we are, how we feel about the outcome, because I'm just going to name it, I'm sure today some of you are elated and you are relieved of the outcome, and some of you are working with some anger, you're disappointed, you're hurt. But we know that no matter what, God's love is available to everyone. I think that's some pretty fruitful insight. And living our best lives is living a life that is filled with love for God first and loving others. If we are going to impact the world, if we are going to preach and to be the living gospel and nurture disciples, then we have to take first fruit living very seriously. For the world watches how we who carry the name of Christ, how we interact with one another. The world is watching and they pay attention to how we treat one another. And if they don't see the love of God flowing through us, then how on earth will anyone ever come to know Christ or see who Christ is? We must bear the resemblance of the Good Shepherd, regardless of whether it is a blood sibling or a sibling in faith. We bear a responsibility to watch out for one another. Don't be pulling that, well, Cain didn't. No, we need to be different. We need to watch out for one another. So if they wander, then we go find them. We need to be like the Good Shepherd. If people are hurting, then we carry them and we protect them from wolves and lions and tigers and bears. Oh my. Our job is to help others fall in love with Jesus. And we are one another's sacred responsibility. Yes, you are your brother's and sister's keeper. During the course of earning her master's degree, a woman found it necessary to commute several times a week from her home to the state university, and it was a good 100 miles away. Coming home late at night, she would see an elderly man sitting by the side of a road. He was always there, in sub-zero temperatures, in stormy weather, no matter how late she returned. He made no acknowledgement of her passing. He just was always there. The snow settled on his cap and his shoulders and as if he were just some old tree sitting by the road. And this woman wondered what brought him to that same spot every evening. What stubborn habit? What private grief? What type of wild thoughts he might have? And she wondered if sometimes she didn't even begin to doubt herself and thinking maybe it wasn't real. Maybe he was a ghost sitting alongside the road. And finally, she asked a neighbor of hers, she said, "Have you seen that old man who sits by the road late at night?" And, "Oh yeah," that neighbor said, "many times, I see him all the time." And she said, that is so odd. Does he ever go home?" Well, the neighbor said, "Well, he's no more odd than you and me. He goes home right after you do. You see, he doesn't like the idea of you driving by yourself late at night all alone on these back roads. So every night he walks out to wait for you. And when your taillights disappear around the bend, he knows that you're okay, and he goes home to bed. Bizarre story. But I kind of wouldn't mind if that man were my neighbor, would you? It's that first fruit type of love that motivates a stranger to care and to watch over someone else. Yes, we are our brothers, sisters, and keepers. And we can do this because we have someone who is desperately watching and waiting and caring for us. And we are of his greatest concern. And we must go and do likewise. So on this day, as we honor the saints that have left us, I cannot think of a better way to celebrate their lives by honoring Christ and by honoring one another. For that is such a beautiful legacy for us to leave. They have left us with some beautiful legacies. You know, here's the thing. Whenever I would go see Bill Nolan, whenever I'd go see him, you know what he'd ask me? I'm going to visit him. And he'd say, how are you doing? He wanted to know how I was. And he wanted to know, how's everybody at church? He wanted to know how everybody else was doing. And somehow I'd walk out of there thinking, but I went to see how you're doing, and here I get this conversation. But he genuinely cared. He celebrated his neighbors. He wanted to know. He wanted to know about everyone. And what a beautiful legacy. See, love is a legacy that lasts. Care and concern are legacies that last. Mother Teresa once said that it's not what you do, but it's how much love you put into it that matters. Love is the secret of a lasting heritage. So the best use of life is love. This best experience of love is time, and the best time to love is now. Our time on earth is short compared to the time that we will spend in eternity. So let us spend our days choosing to love instead of argue, to pray for one another rather than to point fingers, and to invest in our time and our resources in things that really matter, and to leave a legacy that reflects the love of Christ. And may we be a people who practice first fruit living. May we seek, share, and serve him first with all of our being. And may we grow to show the world to be that lasting legacy of love, so that we can say, I was here.
I was here. I crossed this ocean. I walked this path. I lived this life. But what did I leave behind? What evidence will future generations have of my existence? Empty rooms? Faded photographs? Dilapidated buildings? Dust and bones and chiseled stone? The scraps of self, the residue of life. The ripples fade and they come to nothing. A footprint, a census, a statistic. Ink drying on a death certificate, filed away and gone forever. But maybe a legacy isn't material. Maybe a person's impact can't be determined by a calculator. Maybe the ripples of our time on the earth, the love we show, the faith we share, the good we do, the people we help, Maybe they go on forever. Maybe they multiply with time until a snowball becomes an avalanche, a drop becomes a flood, a spark a fire, and a single voice a tumult, roaring to the universe. But I walked this path. I lived this life. I was here.
I am my brother's keeper. I help him to understand what God wants him to, that God wants him to put his whole life in his hand. I am my sister's keeper. I help her to see the light. I encourage her to grow and keep Jesus in her sight. I am my neighbor's keeper. I pray for their family's need. I support them to always listen and to follow where God leads. I am my mother's keeper. In her old age, I help her and I hold her hand when lonely and keep away her doubt. I am my father's keeper. I lift to God his very soul. I pray every day and night that God will make him whole. I am my children's keeper. I listen to their concerns. I pray as they become adults that God's will they can discern. The Lord is my keeper. I pray to him every day to bring me anyone I can help as I go about his way. Let us pray. Jesus, help us to live like you. And we can't do that on our own. We need your mercy and your grace. And day after day after day. Father, we confess our weaknesses, and we continually, times it seems like we continually give in to selfishness and pride. But Father, rather than you throw up your hands in failure, help us to admit our constant need for you. Demonstrate your power through our weakness, and fill our hearts for a desire to grow in love for you and for one another. Let us live in the truth of who we are in you, not who we were before. Make us holy. Make us more like you. Amen. Now, as the praise team sings this next song, I want you to notice that in the pews there are some pens and there are some paper apples. And as they're singing, I want you to think about people whom you are thankful for, people who have been those saints to you into your lives. And you can jot their names down, and then after the worship service today, you can take those apples and you can place them on our Thanks Living tree that is out in the narthex. And then that way, that when we come into this place each Sunday morning between now and until Advent, we are reminded of so many things that we have to be grateful and to be thankful for.
What gift of grace is Jesus my? No more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus.
Dark.
The night is dark, but sin has been defeated. In Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are erased. I can sing, I am free. Yet not I, but through Christ in me.
We have hope first in God, and we can have hope in one another. We are reminded of this as John writes in Revelation chapter 21, and it says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'See, the home of God is now among the people. He will dwell with them, and they will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the old order of things have passed away.' And the one who was seated on the throne said, 'See, I am making all things new.' And also he said, 'Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true.' And then he said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega and the beginning and the end. And to the thirsty, I will give water without cost from the spring of the waters of life.' We have hope in God. His promises are true. And we can have great hope when we go to him in prayer. So today as we pray, as I'm going to read a part of a prayer, and then I will say, Lord, you see, I am making all things new. And then your response would be, Amen. Make all things new. So let us go to God together in prayer. Father, today we come together as your children, lifting up our prayers to you. Father, we pray for those who are lonely. We hope in the promise that the home of God will be among people, that God will dwell with us, and that we will be his people, and that God himself will be with us. We mention in our hearts those whom we know who are lonely and are isolated. Lord, you said, see, I am making all things new. Amen. Make all things new. Father, we pray for those who are crying, the sad, the depressed, and the anxious. We hope in the promise that God will wipe away every tear from our eyes. We mention in our hearts those we know who are sad and those who know tears. Lord, you said, see, I am making all things new. Amen. Make all things new. We pray for those who are experiencing the consequences of death, the bereaved, and for those who are mourning. We hope in the promise that death and mourning will be no more. We mention in our hearts those who we know are affected by death and mourning. Lord, you said, see, I am making all things new. Amen. Make all things new. We pray for those who are in pain and suffering from illness, either physical or mental. We hope in the promise that crying and pain will be no more. We mention in our hearts those whom we know who are ill or in pain. Lord, you said, see, I am making all things new. Amen. Make all things new. Father, we pray for those who are thirsty for truth and love and grace. We seek those who seek God and his life with earnest hearts. Father, we hope in the promise that you will give water to the thirsty without cost from the spring of the water of life. And we mention in our hearts those who we know who hunger and thirst for God. Lord, you said, see, I am making all things new. Amen. Make all things new. Lord, your words are trustworthy and true, and you are the Alpha and the Omega. You are the beginning of the end. And we pray all this in the powerful and hopeful name of Jesus Christ, your Son, who taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Would you please stand and join me as we sing our closing hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. We'll just sing the first verse.
Whatever you choose to do, precede it with hope, accompany it with prayer, and follow it with thanksgiving. Go now in peace and in the shelter of the great hope and love of Christ. Amen.